and SoFloRadio.com present The Nicole Sandler Show.
Truth to power, baby.
And now, here's Nicole.
Hi, everybody. Coming up, Nicole tells your fortune looking ahead. So get out your crystal and stay tuned with Mistress Nicole. All dressed in leather, you won't forget her. You want to love her and you let go. Who's that woman, crazy woman, Nicole?
Chris Isaac would probably fall over if he knew that I was using this as a temporary theme song until we get the new one. I know Jill Sobule is working on it. I think she's on the road. I need to check her schedule. She's been doing the Jill and Julia show. She's doing a live show with Julia Sweeney. That's actually quite funny. But she promised, you know, working on a theme song for me. So we'll just be patient and and deal with Chris Isaac until then. Anyway, good morning. Welcome to a Tuesday. It is the countdown. You know, what's so interesting is because of the nonsense over, you know, the fight over a government shutdown. A lot of, you know, there's a lot happening a week from today, because October 1st is the day that the government will shut down if our wonderful Congress can't get its act together and agree on at least a continuing resolution. And I don't even know what the problem is at this point, because they've all basically agreed that there is going to be no shutdown, right? But they have to go through the motions and take it right up to the wire and play ridiculous games. You know, what's ridiculous about it is that this isn't a game. This is, you know, lives and livelihoods of people, and not to mention the full faith and credit of the United States. I mean, and I know I'm sort of conflating the two, but that, yes, the showdown over a debt ceiling, the raising of the debt ceiling is coming up. There's a whole bunch of stuff on the horizon, and you know, it really sucks. And the only way, we're going to fix this is by voting the people out of office who are the obstructionists, who are working actively to sabotage the government. You know, this clip is actually one of the ones we'll talk about with Laffy in the next hour, but I'm going to play it now because it's so indicative of the problem, right? So on Meet the Press, Meet the Press anyway, there was a roundtable, and I'm trying to remember who all was there. I know Barbara Lee was there. I know Amy Klobuchar was there. Mike Lee of Utah, who is, you know, one of the guys who, along with Ted Cruz, was pushing for the, a shutdown, right? The defunding of Obamacare, right? So Mike Lee, and then Marsha Blackburn. Marsha Blackburn of Tennessee is really one of the more despicable creatures in Congress, because she's so, you know, she looks so nice, yeah, but she says the dumbest things. Yeah, she really, really does. So David Gregory goes around the table and says, so will there be a shutdown here?
Really, yes or no question. Senator Lee, is the government going to shut down?
No, we all know that the government's going to be funded. The question is whether it'll be funded with Obamacare or without.
All right, Senator Klobuchar, you think there'll be a shutdown?
No, because I believe in the end people of goodwill will come together and do the right thing and stop this political brinkmanship.
Okay, so there you had Mike Lee, you had Amy Klobuchar.
So the congresswoman here, Barbara Lee, what do you say?
Barbara Lee.
No, and we're not going to allow the...
And I'm going to interrupt here, because you heard how David Gregory said each name, Senator Lee, Senator Klobuchar, Barbara Lee, Congresswoman, and Marsha Blackburn jumps in without, you know, it steps on Barbara Lee's, words here, and just jumps in with her inane answer. All right, so let me back it up just a tad.
And here, Barbara Lee, what do you say?
Barbara Lee?
No, and we're not going to allow the defunding of the Affordable Care Act.
No, as much as the president wants to shut down, he's not going to get it.
All right, so who wants it, who doesn't want it, is it going to be shut down?
But hold on, say that again, what? Say that again?
The president wants to shut down.
Care Act.
No, as much as the president wants the shutdown, he's not going to get it.
As much as the president wants the shutdown, he's not going to get it. You know, give me a fucking break already. Get over yourselves. The president doesn't want a shutdown, but what he said is, you know, look, we're not going to negotiate here. Now, that opens another whole can of worms, but for now, let's just take him at his word. We'll get into that in a bit. Yeah, because it ain't good. But, you know, this game playing, the president wants a shutdown. You know what? Stop it. But the only way we're going to get them to stop it is if we send a really, really strong message that we're not going to take it anymore. And the only way we can do that is by, you know, showing up on Election Day. And if you want to show up on Election Day, you've got to first register to vote. Did you know that today is National Voter Registration Day? Yeah, neither did I, because, you know, nobody's telling us about it. And the only way that I knew that today was National Voter Registration Day is because Sarah Silverman recorded a new video. Now, I couldn't, even downloading the video and playing it for you, like on the Ustream feed, wouldn't do it justice, because when you view a video, a YouTube video on the YouTube, and I know from, you know, posting videos there, you can, what you do is you can put little annotations on the video, and you can put a little tag that says, click here to subscribe to the channel, or click here to go to the website, right? And so that's part of, you know, the joke. That's part of the joke in this video. But it's Sarah Silverman, and she, I think her best work comes in the really the videos and the pleas that she makes to get people to vote. Remember the boobies in Florida? I don't know if you remember that one, but it was so good. Anyway, here's the audio. Anyway, of the very quick video that Sarah Silverman has out today, and I'll post the actual video on the blog at RadioOrNot.com, so I think the links will work on it, but here you go.
Hi, this is Sarah Silverman. Register to vote at OurTime.org. Not OurTime, the other one, not the elderly dating site. OurTime.org. Uh-huh. Practically the opposite, but also, hopefully, there's love involved. Register to vote at OurTime.org. It's so easy. Do it. Be a part of this world besides just Facebook. But also like us on Facebook. I'm going to make it easy for you. Click right here. Click here, asshole.
Yeah, see, that's the thing.
Click here, fuckface. Asshole's better. It's cleaner.
Asshole's better. It's cleaner. You know, because I thought we needed to start off this Tuesday with a, you know, fuckface reference. Yeah. All right. Today's going to be we'll have some fun, because Laffy's coming up in the second hour, and when she and I get together, we tend to, you know, devolve into sort of a weird place, and I'm sure we will. But we're going to be a little serious in a bit, and the reason is that we're going to talk about a really scary subject, and that is what's happening at Fukushima. And I know if you're just a casual news watcher, you know what, even if you are a you know, a news junkie, you watch the network newscasts, you don't know that there's something really you know, horrific on the horizon at Fukushima. I mean, look, you know that the Olympic Organizing Committee just awarded, I believe it's the 2020 Summer Games, to Tokyo. So I know you're thinking, there's no problem. Japan, everything's good. Fukushima, nah, it hasn't been in the news lately. We're all good. Well, wrong-o, boy. In fact, in a few minutes, we're going to have our friend Gaius Publius on the show. Now, Gaius Publius is blogging at AmericaBlog, and he posted a piece yesterday that seriously scared the bejesus out of me. Not only that, he linked to an article written by my go-to guy on all things having to do with nuclear power, Harvey Wasserman. Now, Harvey Wasserman, I first met, I want to say 5 or 6 years ago, and he wrote a book called Solartopia. But Harvey Wasserman works with Bob Fetrakis. He's, you know, he's an activist, but his main thing is the no nukes movement. And in fact, he's been in on it since the beginning. Harvey Wasserman has been, you know, he was one of the organizers of the no nukes concerts back in the 70s. You know, if you tuned in early for the pre-show music, you heard Plutonium is Forever and Power by John Hall of Orleans, who then went on to become a congressman from New York, John Hall. Sort of, you know, a backbencher, didn't make a lot of noise, but he was there nonetheless. But, you know, Bonnie Raitt, Jackson Brown, Bruce Springsteen, I remember seeing that movie, the No Nukes movie, because I was living down here in Florida at the time, and that was my first, you know, introduction to the dangers of nuclear power. And all of those players, by the way, are still involved in the movement. You have Bonnie Raitt and Jackson Brown, who are really, you know, they are activists. And they, a couple of years ago, went to Congress to lobby against new nuclear power plant government guarantees. Because, you know, no bank will finance a nuclear power plant. They just will not. And so, and thankfully, there hasn't been a new nuclear power plant built in many years, but the problem is that all the nukes that are in operation are operating long beyond their you know, their predicted lifespan. And so, you know, the scary thing is that all of these you know, these plants should be offline by now. They should be done. Right? They shouldn't be in operation anymore. But because we haven't built any new ones, we're sort of stuck with them. And it's just a disaster waiting to happen. And so I know you think, well, the disaster already happened in Japan and it wasn't that bad. First of all, I gotta, let me open the chat again because I don't know if our pal Jeremy is in there. Jeremy, are you in the chat now? Jeremy, don't see him, but maybe Jeremy pops in every now and then. Jeremy is an American living in Japan who, you know, is a regular listener of the show, and maybe he'll bop in. Jeremy knows how to reach me on Skype, and Jeremy, if you are listening and you're just not in the chat, call in, because I want people to hear. You know, and if we don't get you today, if maybe, you know, you're sleeping or whatever, we'll get you on another day to talk about what's going on there. Because, you know, you should be afraid, actually be very afraid. So Gaius Publius is going to join us in a few minutes to talk about the piece he has up at AmericaBlog, which will scare the bejesus out of you. It's called Risky Repair of Fukushima Could Spill 15,000 Times the Radiation of Hiroshima, Create 85 Chernobyls. So we'll go through, and Gaius Publius's post is pretty technical, and it explains exactly what's going on. But before we get to him, I want to share what Harvey Wasserman wrote. And Harvey, you know, has young children, and sometimes the hours of this show don't mesh with him. But I'm going to try to get Harvey back on. If not on this show, then maybe, you know, next week I will be, just so you know, programming note, I'll be guest hosting the morning show at AM 760 in Denver, Tuesday through Friday of next week. So, you know, it's Clear Channel. They're weird about rebroadcasting their stuff. So what I'll do is, like, put up a slide, perhaps, on the Ustream channel, maybe, and on the YouTube, and let you know. You can listen at am760.net. So that's what it'll be. And so maybe we'll get Harvey on there. But let me read to you a little bit of what Harvey Wasserman wrote at commondreams.org. It says, the title is, The Crisis at Fukushima's Unit 4 Demands a Global Takeover. And you know, let me just say, that may not go far enough. It is that scary a situation, just so you know. All right, so Harvey Wasserman writes, We are now within 2 months of what may be humankind's most dangerous moment since the Cuban Missile Crisis. I'm trying to open it on, hold on. I want to open it on on this computer. Screw it. Okay, since the Cuban Missile Crisis, there is no excuse for not acting. All the resources our species can muster must be focused on the fuel pool at Fukushima Unit 4. Fukushima's owner, Tokyo Electric, TEPCO, says that within as few as 60 days, it may begin trying to remove more than 1,300 spent fuel rods from a badly damaged pool perched 100 feet in the air. The pool rests on a badly damaged building that is tilting, sinking, and could easily come down in the next earthquake, if not on its own. That alone should scare the shit out of you. The fact that this spent fuel rod pool is up in the air and the building is unsteady. It's tilting. Anything, you know, a strong gust of wind maybe could blow it over. Some 400 tons of fuel in that pool could spew out more than 15,000 times as much radiation as was released at Hiroshima. You hear this? One thing certain about this crisis is that TEPCO does not have the scientific, engineering, or financial resources to handle it, nor does the Japanese government. The situation demands a coordinated worldwide effort of the best scientists and engineers our species can muster. Why is this so serious? We already know that thousands of tons of heavily contaminated water are pouring through the Fukushima site, carrying a devil's brew of long-lived poisonous isotopes into the Pacific. Tuna irradiated with fallout traceable to Fukushima have already been caught off the coast of California. We can expect far worse. You know, in fact, as I break away from the piece for a moment, you know, we heard that there's, radiation. There's all kinds of debris from the tsunami that has washed up on the West Coast, right? And just as recently as a couple of weeks ago, we were hearing stories again, not reported on by the mainstream media, but certainly out there, that they were, you know, dumping this contaminated water right into the Pacific Ocean. Well, where the hell do you think it goes? From Japan? It crosses the Pacific and shows up right here on our West Coast. For once, I guess I'm happy I live in Florida and not California. Anyway, back to Harvey Wasserman here. TEPCO continues to pour water into the proximate site of three melted reactor cores it must somehow keep cool. Steam plumes indicate fission may still be going on somewhere underground, but nobody knows exactly where those cores actually are. Much of that irradiated water now sits in roughly 1,000 huge but fragile tanks that have been quickly assembled and strewn around the site. Many are already leaking. All could shatter in the next earthquake, releasing thousands of tons of permanent poisons into the Pacific. Note, a relatively small earthquake struck Fukushima Prefecture on Thursday, an indication of the inevitable occurrence of larger ones in the area. The water flowing through the site is also undermining the remnant structures at Fukushima, including the one supporting the fuel pool at Unit 4. More than 6,000 fuel assemblies now sit in a common pool just 50 meters from Unit 4. Some contain plutonium. The pool has no containment over it. It's vulnerable to loss of coolant, the collapse of a nearby building, another earthquake, another tsunami, and more. Overall, more than 11,000 fuel assemblies are scattered around the Fukushima site. According to longtime expert and former Department of Energy official Robert Alvarez, there is more than 85 times as much lethal cesium on site as was released at Chernobyl. Radioactive hotspots continue to be found around Japan. There are indications of heightened rates of thyroid damage among local children. The immediate bottom line is that those fuel rods must somehow come safely out of the Unit 4 fuel pool as soon as possible. Just prior to the 2011 earthquake and tsunami that shattered the Fukushima site, the core of Unit 4 was removed for routine maintenance and refueling. Like some two dozen reactors in the U.S. and many more around the world, the General Electric design pool into which that core now sits is 100 feet in the air. Spent fuel must somehow be kept underwater. It's clad in zirconium alloy, which will spontaneously ignite when exposed to air. Oh, my God. Long used in flash bulbs for cameras. Remember those things? Zirconium burns with an extremely bright, hot flame. Each uncovered rod emits enough radiation to kill someone standing nearby in a matter of minutes. A conflagration could force all personnel to flee the site and render electronic machinery unworkable. I mean, this is the horror, scenario of our time, right? According to Arnie Gunderson, a nuclear engineer with 40 years in an industry for which he once manufactured fuel rods, the ones in the Unit 4 core are bent, damaged, and embrittled to the point of crumbling. Cameras have shown troubling quantities of debris in the fuel pool, which itself is damaged. The engineering and scientific barriers to emptying the Unit 4 pool are unique and daunting, says Gunderson, but it must be done to 100% perfection. Should the attempt fail, the rods could be exposed to air and catch fire, releasing horrific quantities of radiation into the atmosphere. The pool could come crashing to the ground, dumping the rods together into a pile that could fission and possibly explode. The resulting radioactive cloud would threaten the health and safety of all of us. Chernobyl's first 1986 fallout reached California within 10 days. Fukushima's in 2011 arrived in less than a week. A new fuel fire at Unit 4 would pour out a continuous stream of lethal radioactive poisons for centuries. Centuries! Are you hearing this? Former Ambassador Mitsuhide Murata says, Full-scale releases from Fukushima, quote, would destroy the world environment and our civilization. This is not rocket science, nor does it connect to the pugilistic debate over nuclear power plants. This is an issue of human survival. Neither Tokyo Electric nor the government of Japan can go this alone. There is no excuse for deploying anything less than a coordinated team of the planet's best scientists and engineers. We have 2 months or less to act. For now, Harvey Wasserman writes, we are petitioning the United Nations and President Obama to mobilize the global scientific and engineering community to take charge at Fukushima and the job of moving these fuel rods to safety. If you have a better idea, please follow it. But do something and do it now. The clock is ticking. The hand of global nuclear disaster is painfully close to midnight. I mean, it doesn't get much scarier than this. You know, forget, you know, all the horror movies of a, you know, some kind of, you know, bird flu pandemic or something. We are close to a nuclear disaster the size of which we've never experienced, but the thing that people like Harvey Wasserman have been warning us about for decades. Decades. We need to do something. Gaius Publius of AmericaBlog, who's helping to sound the alarm, will join us in just moments. All right, so stick around. Stay tuned. Important stuff coming up. I'm Nicole Sandler. It's Radio or Night and Radio or Not. Ooh, it's got me freaked out. Here's Jim Hightower.
It doesn't take an economics degree to grasp the ugliness in the following statistics. Since the Great Recession supposedly ended in 2009, the incomes of the elite 1%ers have soared by a third, while the incomes of everyone else, the 99%, have barely budged, ticking up by less than one half of 1%. What we have here is the revenge of the robber barons. Like the old barons, today's moneyed powers have taken such control of both the economy and government policy that practically every dime and dollar flows uphill to those at the top. With their ability to get government subsidies, jack up stock prices, and hold down jobs and wages, the infamous 1% has siphoned off 95% of all the income gains America has generated since 2009. In fact, the richest one-tenth of 1% grabbed 60% of that income. Not since the Roaring Twenties has the gap between the really rich and the rest of us been so extreme. This divide is widening, thanks to the avarice of such sorry outfits as International Paper. Early in September, IP spent $1.5 billion to buy back its own stock, plus announcing a dividend hike of 17%. Both maneuvers will further enrich IP's already super-rich big shareholders, a group that just happens to include its top executives. One day later, those same executives announced the dismissal of 1,100 workers and the shutdown of an Alabama paper mill. Longtime, loyal, hard-working employees, plus their families and their local communities, were dumped in the ditch of plutocratic greed to provide more money for the 1%. And Washington just smiles, bizarrely calling for more tax breaks for the rich, as though nothing is amiss in our land of equal opportunity. This is Jim Hightower saying, you don't need a PhD to see the ROB in this.
If you'd like more of Jim Hightower's real populism, check out the Hightower Lowdown. Jim's monthly newsletter gives you the real lowdown on which corporations, by name, are doing what to the middle class, our environment, and our democracy. Each month, the Hightower Lowdown brings you facts you didn't know, along with actions you can take to fight back. It also comes with a sense of humor. Hightower believes we can fight the gods and still have fun. Plus, get this, it's cheap. Only $15 brings you 12 issues a year. For real populism, go to HightowerLowdown.org.
The next time, they're going to be looking at you. And you're going to need a lot of information to know what you're going to want to do. Blind faith in your leaders or in anything will get you killed.
Questioning Authority Daily.
The Nicole Sandler Show on RadioOrNot.com.
I didn't cue in far enough. Let's bring it back to here. And now I went too far. Anyway, playing in the background is the song "Plutonium Is Forever" from the No Nukes concert. You know, that happened back in, I want to say, 1976, and here we are, four decades later, and we're still, you know, singing the same old song. All right, we're calling Gaius Publius. That's where how you'll find him on Twitter. That's the name under which he writes. You find him at AmericaBlog.com. Gaius, you there?
I am. How are you?
I'm okay. How are you?
Well, I'm a little bit freaked out. I think we all should be about this news. You did a very good job of recapping Harvey Wasserman's setup of the problem. It's a political problem,
as well as
an engineering problem.
And a global health problem. Not only health problem, but, you know, survival of the planet. While we're screaming about the Keystone XL pipeline and fracking and, you know, deep water oil drilling and all those things, which I think are warranted, you know, the freaking out over and the fighting against, this should be at the top of everyone's list, because we could have a major catastrophic event for the planet in any moment, you know, in a split second. It could happen.
Well, so this is going to play out over 2 years. The process will start in November. TEPCO, presumably, if they still have control. People should keep in mind, TEPCO's relationship with the Japanese government looks a lot like the BP relationship with the U.S. government,
right,
during the Gulf Coast problem. That is, it seems to be that the government has ceded control to the corporation. So TEPCO is going to start in November trying to remove these spent fuel rods. Most of them are spent. Some of them are actually fully loaded. There's about 200 unspent fuel rods also stored in that container. It's projected to take 2 years. As I believe Wasserman pointed out elsewhere in his article, there is something like a 98% chance of another earthquake,
yes,
in that area over the next 3 years. So do the math. I mean, this is not good.
No, and look, that's the thing. In fact, he pointed out that there was a small trembler just last week. You know, look, having lived in California for many years, I know those things come, you know, very quickly. And when an earthquake happens, you don't get any warning. It just happens. And as was the case in, what year was it, 93, the Northridge quake, you know, you buildings come down, bridges come down, nuclear power plants come down. And we got to remember, the reason the plant at Fukushima is in the shape it's in is because of an earthquake followed by a tsunami. Now, the people who planned this thing were really stupid, because they got hit with a double whammy. If it wasn't sitting right on the ocean, maybe the damage wouldn't be so disastrous because they wouldn't have gotten hit by the tsunami. But the tsunami is really what sort of put the final nail in the coffin of the power plant there, yes?
Oh, absolutely. And in fact, the tsunami was 13 meters, which was 3 meters higher than the 10-meter seawall. So, you know, terrible planning all the way around. Not only that, those reactors are pretty close together.
Right.
They should have been spread out.
You know, this is the other thing. I'm about to post a tweet that we're talking about the current catastrophic problems at Fukushima, but people don't know about it because the corporate media isn't talking about it at all.
Nobody's talking about it. Wasserman is raising the alarm. There's a man at WashingtonPost.com who's raising the alarm. I see, I got to Washington Post via Naked Capitalism. That links page is very good on a lot of subjects. But that's about it. I every now and then you get a link to CNBC has a story or somebody has some audio, but there is nothing mainstream about this. And it really matters. I mean, this really matters. You would think that maybe behind closed doors aren't the people who are supposed to be in charge whispering to each other about it maybe and just saying, let's not alarm the little people, but God, I hope they're talking to each other about
this.
Well,
you would think so. You know, somebody in the chat room said, well, TEPCO isn't talking about it because they don't want to scare their shareholders. And as you just said about, you know, maybe you'll hear something on CNBC about it. The only time I'm and I don't watch CNBC, I have, you know, no money to invest in, that's what they do. You know, it would only be on that note. And let me tell you something. If there's a meltdown, if the building that Reactor 4 is housed in, these spent fuel rod pools, if this thing goes over, we're not going to have to worry about money, are we?
There's a scientist who's in this industry who's Australian, apparently, from her accent, and she gave a speech in which she said, was answering questions, and she said, if the whole thing, so that we could talk about how the stages in which this could go, but if it goes through all three stages of disaster, she's moving her grandchildren to Australia.
Wow. And Australia, I guess, yes. You see,
Southern Hemisphere.
Exactly. So it's the other side, literally the other side of the planet. Because on this side of the planet, you know, I said half jokingly, for once, I'm happy I'm living in Florida and not California. Because California is already getting stuff from Japan. Is it safe to eat seafood anymore? I always said, you know, and I haven't been very good on this front, but after the Deepwater Horizon disaster in the Gulf of Mexico, you know, again, I live in Florida, I said I wasn't going to eat shrimp anymore, or before I ate shrimp, in a restaurant, I'd always ask where it came from, and of course, I haven't done that. I don't eat a lot of shrimp, but I don't think we're safe with any seafood we eat anymore.
Well, it's hard to say. I don't know how to answer that question precisely. I know that as of the last 10 years, there were cards that we would get. I'm on the West Coast.
Mm-hmm.
There were cards that we would get for reference in restaurants. These fish caught these ways are safer than these fish caught these ways. A lot has to do with whether they're large fish that are deep ocean fish.
Mm-hmm.
For example, tuna
mm-hmm.
Will store more mercury in their large bodies. They will go deeper. They will collect more mercury. Other fish, like salmon, will obviously be safer if they're wild as opposed to farmed.
Right.
And so forth. So there's variations in whether you can eat fish or not.
Right. And you know what?
I'm sure that noose is tightened.
Yeah, absolutely. But look, on all fronts, the food isn't safe. You know, just look at what Monsanto is doing to the crops. And for instance, in California, because of Monsanto's lobbying money, the good people of California voted down a bill that would simply require, food producers to label if there's any genetically modified stuff in that food. So we don't know what we're eating, regardless of where it comes from. And I can ask till I'm blue in the face where this shrimp was from. And they could say, oh, it's from, the Northern Atlantic. Sure, okay. We don't know. We don't know. But again, it might be a moot point. Now, what would happen? Let me ask you, and not to scare anyone, but I think we need to scare people to do something about this. What would happen in a worst-case scenario? What happens, Gaius Publius, say, you know, another earthquake hits and that Reactor 4 building comes down?
Well, let's look at the three stages of things that could go wrong, the
okay.
three ways things could go wrong.
Okay.
First, there's the reactor unit 4, which has a problem. Then there's, and they have 1,300 spent fuel rods stored 150 feet above the air in Unit 4, underwater in a pool that's leaking, and that is being flooded with seawater, which is corrosive to that zirconium, rather than fresh water.
Right.
So we've got 1,500 fuel rods there. Nearby in a common storage pool, we've got 6,300 fuel rods. And then throughout the entire facility, six reactors, we've got 11,400 fuel rods, and I'm rounding to the nearest 100. So the first thing that could happen is something could happen to Reactor 4. If they go to the post at AmericaBlog or to Harvey Wasserman's post, they can get a look at what Reactor 4 building looks
and,
like.
And I
it's
will,
a shell.
Right,
it's
and I will, in fact, I'm going to put that picture up on the Ustream right now, but I'm going to post the links to both stories on the blog at RadioOrNot.com. But if you're watching the Ustream feed right now, that is the building at 4, you'll notice there's no roof there. So that the pool that these spent fuel rods are in is exposed to the air, isn't it?
It's exposed to the air, and it's leaking, and they don't know the condition of the rods in the pool. They know there's debris at the bottom of the pool. There would have to be, because the pool has to be open to the cranes that lift the rods in and out in a covered building.
Right.
The cranes would operate.
Sure.
But right now, it's an uncovered building, so Lord knows what's in that pool. They do not know. TEPCO does not know what's in that pool.
Oh my God!
So, as think of these rods being stored in racks vertically, so that they're kind of lined up in a row, each one held in its little racked position. In a normal circumstance, a crane would come in that's computer-driven, reach down, it knows to the millimeter where every rod is, grab a rod, lift it entirely vertically straight up, still underwater, move it to wherever it needs to move, and ship it around to the rest of the building. We've got, think of that as a pack of cigarettes, standing on end with the top off. That pack of cigarettes is now crumpled. Those racks are distorted. The room is distorted. What they're going to try to do is to lift those fuel rods up through that holding rack.
Uh-huh.
But those rods are bent. The racks are distorted. The likelihood of breaking or bending, further bending or dropping one of those rods is relatively high. So you've got the possibility of a fire around that zirconium clading, because that zirconium is giving off hydrogen in its current situation. If it gets to the air, because the air will not cool the zirconium the way the water will, which is the function of the water.
Uh-huh.
At some point, you may get a collapse of all of that material in Building 4 caused by either what TEPCO does or by another tsunami and another earthquake, as you point out, in which case you've got a fire there. Does that fuel rod pool become critical? Does it become explosive? We don't know, but that's the first possibility. If only the 1,300, 1,500 fuel rods goes up, we've got X amount of radiation that's going to be released into the air and across the Pacific. If the explosion is enough to explode the common fuel pool, which is stored nearby, 6,000 more fuel rods, then the amount of radiation released is larger. It's probably six times larger, five times larger, given the number of rods stored. And you can double that if the whole site goes up. If the whole site goes up, we're looking at 65 times the release of cesium from Chernobyl into the air.
Wow. Wow. And again, you know, we have the jet stream. It comes across the ocean. So this is not something that's just limited to the people of Japan. And I say Japan because I got to say, I was actually stunned when I heard the announcement a couple of weeks ago that the Olympic Organizing Committee awarded the 2020 Olympics to Tokyo. Do you know Tokyo is 148.1 miles or 128.6 nautical miles from Fukushima. That's frightening. I'm sorry.
It's a triumph of PR over anything like good sense.
I guess. So Gaius Publius is with us. Now, obviously, there are people who go, oh, phooey. Now, look, what I've known, because I've, again, been, oh, God, I never turned this off. What I've been studying, you know, the issues relating to nuclear power, you know, for a while now. I do my research. I don't just say, oh, someone tells me it's bad, I believe it's bad, because I trust the person. I still do research. And the problem with nuclear power is not the power it puts out, obviously, it's the waste. And there's always been an issue. These fuel rods, what are spent fuel rods, are the fuel rods that are no longer good for generating power, but they're still radioactive, and there is no safe way to dispose of them. And the half-life is certainly longer than our lifetimes, so that's the problem, and that's why these spent fuel rods are so dangerous. And there's more and more of them, especially in these power plants around the world that may be obsolete but are still in use, yet there's no way to safely dismantle them and get rid of the waste.
Yes, fuel rods are radioactive when they contain a full tank of gas, so to speak, and the waste is radioactive as well. Among the waste is plutonium, which is one of the most deadly substances that you could ever get yourself around. You don't want to be around plutonium. The cesium is bad. There's all kinds of poison. It's radioactive poison that's in this stuff. It's terrible. There's no way to store it. And the worst part of it is that reactor design, that General Electric reactor design, the Mark One, which was used in reactors 1 through 4. There's a Mark Two in reactors 5 and 6. That Mark One is in use around the world.
Yeah,
including
in the United States, and so what do you say? Like, I've got a guy who, you know, I'm sure he's using his real name in the chat room, Chip Chipperson, but the trolls invaded the chat room since they found out you and I were talking about this, and he writes, "Oh, Nicole, it's just a bunch of hooey." Really, Chip Chipperson, go live near Fukushima.
Well, that's the test, isn't it?
Yeah.
I mean, one of the CEOs of something is talking about the safe amount of benzene, and my thought is, great, let's have that safe amount of benzene in your living room, see if you like it.
You're right.
Yeah. This is the problem. And the fact is, there could be nothing. I mean, Chip Chipperson could have his dream fulfilled,
right,
and that nothing bad will happen.
Absolutely.
Doesn't proof that nothing bad could happen, but it means we dodged a bullet, and that's a good thing. The range of possibilities is really wide in this one, very, very wide, but we still have to be looking at that dangerous end of the options, because I don't think the chance of that last option is zero. It's actually relatively high. If you get a nuclear critical explosion in Unit 4, what are the odds that all of the site will go up into the air? I think that's got to be at least 20 or something percent.
It's
not like 1%.
I would think so. You know, look,
these things are tight together. These facilities are very close together in this site.
Right, and it can blow up. Look, we haven't had, thankfully, a whole lot of experience with disasters of this type. But what do things look like at Chernobyl right now?
You know, I haven't looked at Chernobyl. I think that Chernobyl is yesterday's news. It's kind of a been there, done that.
But
just like Three Mile Island.
The point I'm getting at is, can people live there?
You're making the point that can anybody live there? No, I don't think anybody can.
Exactly.
Live there.
It is a dead zone. You can't go there. It is a part of the planet that is just it is off limits. It is, you can't be there. And I think people who lived around that have very high instances of, you know, certainly thyroid cancer, but other types of cancers. You know, Three Mile Island, also, there are health issues. So at the very least, what you're going to have are generations of people who are, you know, who've been, you know, who've been made very, very sick because of this. You know, our friend Jeremy, who doesn't seem to be in the chat room today, is an American living in Tokyo. And, you know, even he and I have spoken online a few times since the earthquake and tsunami, and he talked about how there's an elevated level of thyroid cancer, how people are sick. And look, and this, you know, it's all still standing, you know, that we haven't had the major meltdown, and I'm afraid we will.
Well, Japan's in a unique situation. Chernobyl is in the middle of a large expanse of landmass where
it can be isolated.
And the stuff drifts west. Japan is a very tight place. It's a tight, highly populated place. There are consequences for Japan here that go beyond just the health consequences. The cost of cleaning this up is likely, it could bankrupt the country if it really goes bad. Not only that, they could lose sovereignty. I mean, what if the rest of the world comes in and says, you can't handle this, we're handling it for you. All of a sudden, you've got not just loss of face, but actual loss of government of your own country. If they have to evacuate Tokyo, what is the situation in Japan if Tokyo and some of the other large cities in that immediate vicinity have to be evacuated south? It would be absolute chaos for them. And talk about a marker for the rest of the world. It would be a lesson for the rest of us to get off nuclear power, but at what price? A horrible price.
Horrible. And you know, Gaius Publius is with us. He wrote a very frightening piece. It's up at AmericaBlog. I'll have a link to it on my blog at RadioOrNot.com after the show. But there's a lot of technical stuff here. There are drawings that show exactly where this spent fuel pool is, and you know how high it is off the ground. And again, this is the thing that's, you know, one of the things that's so dangerous, obviously. But this thing, there's such a danger of it falling, and in fact, we have the same exact design right here at some of the plants in the U.S. Now, one of the problems, one of the many problems is that I don't think there's, and I could be wrong here, please correct me if I am, that I don't think there's a single nuclear power plant currently operating in the U.S. that isn't beyond its you know projected lifespan.
That could easily be true because we have not been building new ones.
Right.
The ones that we have to be old. What the sell by date on these things is, I don't know, but it's been what, over a decade? You probably know better.
Oh,
than
longer
I do.
Than that.
More than
it's
a decade.
Been decades.
That we've built a new power
decades.
Plant.
And one of the reasons is that no bank will finance it. So the government is the one who steps in and does the loan guarantees. And there was such an outcry, it was a year or two ago, and in fact it's when the site nukefree.org went up, and I'm saying it's 5 years ago already, because I remember when it went live, I had Harvey Wasserman on my show. He's the editor of that site. Bonnie Wright and Jackson Brown, a bunch of the artists who were involved in the original No Nukes movement, along with some younger artists, I guess, all went to D.C. to lobby to say, do not guarantee any loans for new nuclear power plants, and none have been built. So I think, at least to some extent, it was successful. Of course, then Fukushima happened, and although the Obama administration is still on paper supportive of nuclear power, which blows my mind, there hasn't been any action to build a new one. And you know, but what I have learned is many of them are past that date, the expiration date, if you will. The good news is that the San Onofre plant in Southern California, I think, has been shut down, hasn't it?
I do not know.
I believe
not,
it has.
You're close. Yeah. Actually, I was going to say you're closer to California,
well,
but you're not.
No, I'm not. Well, I used to live there. In fact, San Onofre, if you Google a picture of it, it's again, just like Fukushima, it's right on the coast. It's in northern San Diego County, like by Oceanside, a little bit north of that. And as you drive down the highway, it's Interstate 5 down there, I believe, you know, you see these two... It looks like two giant boobs sticking up from the beach. You know, roundly, you know, they look like breast implants because they're perfectly round.
They have a unique shape, don't they?
It looks
there's
like...
something about that that says, yes, nuclear, stay
right.
away.
Yeah, there's a woman, like a giant woman, you know, sunbathing on the beach, and all you see are her two giant boobs sticking up. But yes, I believe that has been decommissioned because, again, it was kept in operation long past its, you know, obsolescence date. And so... You know, but so you, Harvey Wasserman in his piece mentioned a petition, and in fact, I believe your piece does as well, to get the world involved. Again, sometime in the next 60 days, they are going to start, trying to remove these spent fuel rods from that building of, you know, Nuclear Reactor 4. And the danger is, as you point out, Gaius Publius, that they don't have the technology or the knowledge or the money to do this right. And this is the kind of thing in which there can be no errors.
And I mentioned PR for a reason. TEPCO has been using their PR money for crisis management and happy talk and, as you say, smoothing the feathers of the stockholders and all of that. I'd like to place this in a larger context, if you don't mind.
Please.
That larger context is climate change. We're talking about nuclear power because the world is getting it that we have to get off carbon.
Mm-hmm.
And now that nuclear card is not going to be able to be played anymore, which means that we have to talk about climate change and carbon alternatives without nuclear on the table. That's actually a very good thing because nuclear is one of those, you let in the mice and you get in a couple of the rats as well. Well, nuclear power is one of the rats that came in with the, here's an alternative to carbon. I've got a major post up today about climate change, in fact, and we're going to get climate change news coming up very soon because AR5, the IPCC's assessment report 5, is about to be released. And hopefully that restarts the conversation of how is the world going to get its energy without killing itself, which is really the major story, of which Fukushima is a large minor part.
You know, and I'm looking at that piece now. It's entitled Climate Crisis. We could see 7 degrees Celsius, that's 12 degrees Fahrenheit, warming and mass extinction by 2100. I guess the good news is I'll be long dead by then. But my kid, and certainly if I have any grandchildren, they'll be around.
We have children, and many of us will not be dead. You may not be dead.
You
may be wonderfully long-lived and happy and healthy.
Yeah. But the bottom line is these are the kind of things we need to stop. And
we're sitting in year 1500 planning for something that could happen in 2000. This is planning for something that will happen in the lifetime of the youngest people alive today.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely. Look, I have some friends. We were at a party on Saturday night. And we found out the good news that Lisa's pregnant. And after, you know, the rejoicing and feeling very happy for them, I couldn't help but think, wow, you know, I can't imagine what this child's life is going to be because we're destroying the planet. And forget about the political situation here. I mean, hopefully, this country will get its shit back together if the planet is still, you know, standing, so to speak.
Well, let's do that framing a little differently.
Okay.
We're not destroying the planet. The planet will be fine. We're destroying
life
it as an environment that we can live in.
An environment that sustains life.
That's correct. It sustains our life. There will be life. I mean, I don't think life is going to disappear
the
Earth.
I'll show you. And for the people watching
insects and microbes. And,
yeah, for the people watching on Ustream, there's a picture I have up there. It's Japan's new Olympic logo. It's a fish, the type of fish you would see on The Simpsons, and it's got five eyes that are in the Olympic rings. That's the kind of creatures that will be living here long after we're gone, right?
Well, if we get the nuclear disaster, it's a different kind of thing than if we get the overheating
disaster.
That's
right.
True.
It's not a rosy picture. So
why were we born now? Why couldn't we born some other time?
Well, because things were horrific back then, too. I mean, if you could pick a time in history that you would have wanted to live, when would it be?
I don't know. It's got to be post-electricity.
Right. Right, because
and that limits you right there.
Yeah, I mean, look, do you want to live, you know, during slavery times here? Do you
no.
want to, you know? I mean, look, every generation has had like serious problems, and I guess at some point, people had the thought that they were coming up on the end of the world, the end of, you know, life as we know it. But you know, the days of nuclear proliferation, the days, you know, after, sorry, we dropped bombs on Japan, there are probably people who thought the world was ending. But that would have been on purpose because somebody dropped a nuke. And look, with Pakistan having nukes, who knows? You know, things could blow up any day. But this, you know, this I guess could be fixed. Yes, Jay Jewell in the chat room says cockroaches will be fine. Cockroaches will always be fine. They will always live unless you step on them with a heavy shoe. But, you know, this is something that we could fix. And the point, I guess, that Harvey Wasserman is making in his piece is that we need to push our elected officials to do something. We need to push the White House. You know, again, they have a petition up at moveon.org to get us involved. Look, as much as I think we shouldn't be involved, for instance, in Syria's civil war, We need to be involved in this because it has to do with saving the planet. And what it says, the petition statement reads like this. At Fukushima Unit 4, the impending removal of hugely radioactive spent fuel rods from a pool 100 feet in the air presents unparalleled scientific and engineering challenges. With the potential for 15,000 times more fallout than was released at Hiroshima, we ask the world community, through the United Nations, to take control of this uniquely perilous task. I'm going to sign it right now. I will post links to this petition. Right now they're at 11,172 signatures. It's going to be delivered to the Secretary General of the UN and Barack Obama. And you know what? Now is the exactly right time because the General Assembly is in session.
Yes. Yes. There's some interesting timings around Barack Obama at the moment. Glenn Greenwald, to get on a slightly different subject, has noted that Barack Obama is due to speak right after the president of, I believe it's Brazil, who is about to complain about
NSA
stuff has been done to Brazil. They're talking about an alternate internet in Brazil, by the way. The balkanization of the internet has started.
Yes, well, Brazil is making, this is a topic for another day, but Brazil is taking a really, radical stance here, and good for them, and it should be noted that Glenn Greenwald lives in Brazil. I mean, he lived there because of his, his status as a couple, and the U.S., this obviously moved there before the Defense of Marriage Act was ruled unconstitutional, but, he's in a same-sex relationship, and I guess they have an easier lifestyle in Brazil. But anyway, the fact that Brazil is taking such a heavy stance against the U.S. and the NSA's not only domestic spying, they're mad at the international spying.
Well, yes. I mean, the all of South America is actually the group that's getting its back up over the fact that the coalition of the first world security state that for example, the plane of the president of, I believe it was Ecuador, was forced down.
Mm-hmm.
It was forced down because it was denied landing in three or four European countries, all of them obviously operating at the command of the United States, or the request, in quotes, of the United States. Well, you know, somebody's got to stand up to this conglomerate of everybody owns everybody and you can't know what we're doing. And it's happening in Latin America. So good for them.
Yep.
Brazil is at the forefront, but it's not the only country at the forefront. And the ones that are standing up are Latin Americans.
And let's, take it even a step further and say, this is the time that we all need to get involved. And it's on all these fronts, too. It's on, saying to our government, on this instance, please get involved. Please, let's, take the lead on this because we do have the knowledge. For this, I think we should spend the money. Boy, it's a hell of a lot different than, spending money to bomb another country that's in the midst of a civil war where bombing them wouldn't help anything, just would kill innocent people. On this one, though, we can take a lead and help, save the planet. it seems like a no-brainer.
And I would, going back to something I mentioned earlier, more casually or lightly, we the people alive today, at least in the first world, are living in the golden era of the world.
Mm-hmm.
If you go back 100 years and you're in the wealthy class, one of the benefits you have is that you've got money and servants, but you've got to wear those clothes, and those clothes are incredibly restricting. Think of people walking around today in T-shirts, and mm-hmm. that's office wear. We're really living in a culture that has produced a quality of life for those of us who, and it's a larger number than normal, who enjoy it, that's unparalleled in the history of the world. We just have to protect that, that's all. It's not all bad.
No.
Everybody has to protect. We have to protect. But what we're protecting is something very good.
There you go. Gaius Publius, find him certainly on the Twitters and definitely at AmericaBlog.com. I'll post links to all the pieces we talked about and his Twitter feed as well. Thank you so much. This is a really important subject. I know it was heavy, but I'm glad we talked about it.
Always my pleasure, Nicole.
All right, you take care. It is now time for the news. Oh, boy. And joining us today to tell us what the hell is going on is Bob Ney from the Talk Radio News Service. Good morning, Bob.
Hello, how are you?
Hi, crazy. In fact, we just got finished a lengthy discussion that's really scary about what is going on at the Fukushima power plant. Are you aware of what's happening there?
No, I mean, I don't know the latest. You're talking about the one in Japan.
Yeah.
That they've had all the trouble with.
Right, and what's happening now is, you know, there sometime within the next 60 days, TEPCO, the Tokyo Electric Power Company, is going to start removing the spent fuel rods from nuclear reactor number 4. And this is a really perilous procedure, aside from the fact that that building that houses this one reactor was so damaged in the earthquake and the tsunami that it's tilted and it's, you know, there's danger of it coming down. Very respected scientists tell us that the dangers in it being left alone or in the whole process of removing these spent fuel rods, it has the potential for 15,000 times more fallout than was released at Hiroshima.
They wanted to use it as some kind of training facility. Did you know that? It gets more bizarre. They seriously wanted to use it as some kind of training facility.
Oh, my God. No, it's such a precarious situation right now that, I mean, it could render a good portion of Japan, if not all of Japan, uninhabitable, not to say what the fallout would do to the rest of the planet.
Yeah, they wanted to make it some kind of training base. And, I think probably to handle, you know, nuclear situations, but they can't even handle, you know, what's going on with this one.
Right, and there's a petition now saying that the world community needs to step in and take charge because, you know, the Japanese government doesn't have the knowledge or, even the financial wherewithal to do this, and there's no room for error. And so this is something that via the United Nations, the world needs to step in. I mean, look, we're so quick to want to step in and bomb some country that's embroiled in a civil war. How about stepping in to try to make sure that, you know, that we save lives and we save the planet as a place that can foster human life?
Right.
It's very scary. Very, very, very scary. And the media is not discussing it at all. But this is going to happen sometime in the next 2 months. They're going to start this process.
Right. And because they were saying at one time that everything was coming from one tank, but I think it was physically impossible. It goes way beyond, you know, some bolts being loose there.
Oh, absolutely. Well, the building is already leaning, and so, you know, another, you know, powerful earthquake could bring it down, and then, you know, all bets are off. But this needs to be done. And even if it doesn't come down, it's still the process of removing these spent fuel rods, which is just, it's frightening. It really, really is frightening. Anyway, we'll try to keep, a spotlight on this because, again, the media is ignoring it.
You don't hear much at all.
Yes, no, and right now, of course, the United Nations General Assembly is in session, so this is a great time to get the United Nations to at least take notice of it. But I think Japan is being really quiet about it. TEPCO doesn't want to upset their shareholders. You know, look, at some point, some things are more important than money.
That's right.
What is going on? There's we were talking in the last segment just very briefly that Brazil, the country of Brazil, is so incensed about the NSA's activities, their surveillance methods, not only of, you know, not, I don't even know that it's about the U.S. citizens, but foreign entities, that they are like disconnecting from the internet or something, and they want to start their own internet system. Somehow related story, we might remember back to this when the news broke. It was before the NSA stuff broke, but we heard that the government was, the FBI was tapping into phones of Associated Press reporters and whole bureaus and everything. This story has finally come full circle, yes?
Yes, you know, the president of Brazil, we spied directly on him, and that's everybody
what it is.
Just, you know. And now there is a sentencing, and I think it's going to be a plea deal, and it's because the FBI agent, who also was into some child porn, that was another secondary issue they were going after him for.
Yep.
But now it's been revealed, you know, they've got him on a plea deal that's going to occur about calling Associated Press. This is a former FBI agent that then became a contractor and, you know, leaked information. And we find out now that this has all come to a conclusion that they went through phone records, of course, phone records of of the reporters. And then Associated Press will still not comment because they won't comment on sources.
Right. So in the meantime, this this former FBI bomb technician, who then later worked as a contractor for the FBI, has agreed to plead guilty to disclosing national defense information in the Associated Press about a disrupted terrorist plot, but he's also going to serve time in this deal for child pornography. That's just weird.
That's right. Yes, it is, because you looked at that and I thought, you know, which came first, chicken or the egg, you know, on the charges. And the whole thing just, I don't know, it turned into a very, very strange story that comes and goes, and they looked into the reporter's files. I noticed on the comments on the story, people said, wow, you see, this is a good reason they need to spy on people.
Right.
Where do you go with that?
I do not know. I do not know.
I mean, I'm not saying he didn't do some bad things. I mean, he had a child porn situation, which was terrible. But on the other issue with the information, I don't know. And other people have actually said things on television and weren't prosecuted to that extent. So I don't know.
I don't know either. There are lots more that we don't know in the news. I guess that's a good segue into what the hell is going on in Congress.
This is about the end of Ted Cruz.
Yeah, it sounds that way. He is the most hated man in Washington by people in both parties, yes?
Well, it's the end of him because you have the House, which did the continuing resolution that funds the government till December 15th, and they put in the defunding of Obamacare. They send it to the Senate. Here's Ted Cruz. He's, talking about Churchill, and he'll fight to the end, just like Churchill did, et cetera, on TV with Senator Lee from Utah, Republican. Next thing you know, Harry Reid, in a very convoluted system, what called cloture, where Harry Reid, the Democratic leader, needs 60 votes to bring a bill to the floor to discuss it. He doesn't have 60 votes. Well, guess what? He does now, because Republicans, including the Republican leader Mitch McConnell, are giving him the 60 votes to bring this to the floor. Harry Reid, the Democratic leader, will then remove the defunding mechanism on Obamacare, send it back a day before the government shuts down to John Boehner, Republican Speaker of the House, and the House can do what they want, shut down the government or continue to run it without Obamacare defunding. Now, this is a little bit different than the 968 votes to defund Obamacare. This thing actually got into a continuing resolution of the government. What's interesting here, and you know, you've been around a long time, how do you then, as being Ted Cruz, go out and say the Democrats and the White House, how do you do it? No, it's Mitch McConnell with the Republicans.
Right, and Mitch McConnell, finally, yesterday, he's been silent on it because I guess he's got a primary challenger from the right, and so he didn't want to, you know, come out against this, but he finally had to. I mean, look, this is happening now. He had to take a stand one way or another, and he said no.
And it's just amazing. Where do you go from here if you're Ted Cruz? Now, at first, it stimulated debate on the issue, and people followed, but look, if you are a Tea Party follower, and if you don't like Obamacare, how do you turn around and say, oh, well, Ted's fighting the good fight, you know, the Democrats did this and that, when the Democratic side in the Senate got votes from the Republican side to consider this whole thing, to take it out? And So, you know, I think the steam's gone now.
Well, I should hope so. And look, you would think. In fact, I saw there was a somewhat reasonable Republican on Hardball last night from New York. I think he represents, like, Staten Island. But you would think that now would be the time for those in the Republican Party who are fed up with the Tea Party antics to say, look, I may not like this law, but it is law. It's not a bill anymore. It's a law. Not only did Congress pass it, but the Supreme Court upheld its constitutionality, and then the people reaffirmed it by re-electing President Obama and giving Democrats a big win in 2012. As much as we don't like it, what we should do is, you know, let it be implemented and then work to fix the things that are broken in it, not sabotage it.
Because the Democratic side is going to have to be very, not the Congress, but the administration, the executive, is going to have to be very, very careful with this. If it does turn into a nightmare, it has horrible flaws, et cetera, they have to be careful how they implement it. So it's not enough to just have this debate funded or defunded. It's here. It's upheld, as you said, by the decision of a Republican on the Supreme Court, you know, Roberts, that sided with the decision. And so it's here. And you're right, and if things happen and it's not implemented correctly, then how do you go back to the defunded argument? You know, look, once a law is here, they're usually here, whether people like them or not.
Yeah, no, exactly. That's the thing. And so work to make it better. Look, nothing is perfect, and Medicare certainly was far from perfect from what I've read when it was implemented. And, you know, you have to make tweaks to it to make it better. We certainly, look, this Affordable Care Act was not the health care reform I wanted to see. There's a lot that's wrong with it, but you implement it, then you work out the kinks, you work out the problems, you amend it as you go along to make it better, but you don't try to sabotage it. And I'll tell you, Bob, I get so infuriated when I hear these right-wingers, these Republican congressmen, you know, say this is what the American people want. They want to kill Obama. Well, no, it isn't what the American people want. We voted the way we did because we want people who were unable to get health insurance to be able to get health care. And so that will happen. There will be problems with it. I hope that the people we entrust to represent us in Washington will work to fix the problems.
They went too far with this one in the sense of not looking at the total picture. People are more willing to accept hardball tactics, which both parties can do, if it's generically for the good. For example, you know, they're not bad. They haven't passed a budget in ages and years,
right,
in the Congress.
Why they're not
and
even
then
talking
they
about that now?
Comprehensive look. They narrowed in on Obamacare. It's done now. It's done. And it was. It's now the Republicans in the Senate that House crew is going to argue.
Right.
It's done.
Right. Well, that's the thing. So, but now, because of his grandstanding, and I got to say, I see those Ted Cruz commercials, defund Obamacare, but there are just as many Mike Lee commercials that run on my TV, and he's the one now saying, you know, maybe not, but we got your phone numbers and we got some money from you suckers. But now they're going to do it again over the debt ceiling, yes?
And they're going to have to pass something, because it's just the way to win these battles and make their point is through the budget and appropriations process. I mean, the debt, they haven't passed a budget, so they have to raise the debt ceiling.
Right.
Or default.
Right.
There's 100 other ways that they can push and negotiate through bill by bill by bill.
Well,
they haven't done it.
To keep threatening to, you know, hold their collective breaths until their faces turn blue, I mean, I'm sorry, my kid's not in kindergarten anymore. I thought I was past that. Now they're acting like my, you know, terrorist teenager, which is the new phrase that I've coined. Forget about the terrible twos. We have terrorist
teens. I've been
through
two teenagers.
Girls or boys?
One boy, one girl.
And was the girl worse than the boy?
No.
Really?
Not for me.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I have the teenage
maybe,
daughter from
maybe
hell.
Maybe your mom, but not for me.
Oy, oy, oy. All right. Bob Ney, it's a crazy world. Thank you for
Thank you.
Filling us in on it. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Sorry, I didn't mean to cut off Bob Nay. Yeah, it is nuts. And so the day that Obamacare, that the exchanges go live, a week from today, next Tuesday, when, by the way, you will have to listen to this show via AM760.net, because from Tuesday through Friday of next week, I'll be filling in on their morning show. You know, we'll do a lot of what we do here, but I'll have the ability to take calls. So, and I'll remind you, and I'll put up a note on the website, AM760.net, next Tuesday through Friday. But anyway, Tuesday is the day that the exchanges go live, but it also might be the day that the government shuts down. So what the hell happens if the government shuts down? Will the exchanges still be live, and will there be people manning the phones 24/7? I don't know. I'll try to find out the answer. All right. We'll take a break. We'll come back with GottaLaff of thepoliticalcarnival.net next. Don't go away. I'm Nicole Sandler. It is radio or not.
This is the Media Matters Minute. I'm Tyler Hansen. Fox News' Greg Jarrett repeatedly pressed Republican Congressman Patrick Meehan to declare that the Obama administration has been engaged in a cover-up of the September 2012 attacks on U.S. diplomatic facilities in Benghazi, Libya.
Is this a cover-up, and is it blatant?
Well, it is certainly not a thorough investigation in the way that it was advertised. And that's the key. They've been relying on this as if it was a dispassionate and thorough investigation.
You don't want to call it a cover-up.
Well, you know, you can call it a cover-up. I think they asked the right questions.
Why don't you call it a cover-up? That's what I'm asking.
Because I think I want to see accountability. I think that they're asking questions, but they're failing to ask the right people the questions all the way to the top.
Well, and it's been a year, which is ridiculous.
This continues the network's repeated creation and promotion of lies, smears, and conspiracies related to Benghazi. For more on this story, visit MediaMatters.org.
Never know who or what you'll hear when you listen to the Nicole Sandler Show at RadioOrNot.com.
Bill Maher, you're here in Miami on Friday night. You're doing a show at the Fillmore at the Jackie Gleason Theater. They just renamed this theater the Fillmore. And they put up a couple of psychedelic posters. So I guess...
Was it the theater Jackie did his TV show
for? Yes.
Oh, wow.
What I hear they did is put up two of those old Bill Graham posters and renamed it.
Yeah, I can't think of two different icons of show business.
Yeah, really.
Bill Graham and Jackie Gleason.
Yeah, why they just didn't play up the Jackie Gleason aspect, I don't know. But then again, this is South Florida.
Right. Okay.
Welcome to it.
I feel warm.
The Nicole Sandler Show, live Monday through Thursdays at 10 a.m. Eastern.
Or
podcast anytime at RadioOrNot.com.
Tales of American Political History with Clinton Porter Hackney.
Really big deals sometimes happen accidentally after a series of small, random events culminate into unexpected results. Such was the case in New York State in the summer of 1969. The 1960s had begun with much optimism and hope in America, led by the swearing-in of a young, dynamic John Kennedy and his vision of the New Frontier program. And in fact, there were great successes with civil rights advancements, American leadership in the world, and technological achievements crowned by Americans landing on the moon. But just a few weeks after that moon landing, one of those accidental big deals arose to remind us of the clashes of the Vietnam War, the violence arising from the civil rights movement, assassinations of leaders, and the rebellion of middle-class teens. Like Elvis and Einstein, it became identified by one word, Woodstock. Join us again for the politics surrounding the Woodstock Music and Art Fair. This is Clinton Porter Hackney at cphackney.com.
Hey, kids, it's time for the Political Carnival and Gotta Laugh with the Nicole Sandler Show.
All righty then. This is the time of the week. Every week we check in with our buddy, Gotta Laugh. She's at thepoliticalcarnival.net. Hello.
Yes, you've reached the post-Emmy Award Show hotline.
Oh, boy, cool.
Press 1 if you think the GOP should have won an Emmy for Outstanding Civil War Documentary.
Yeah, I guess.
Press 2 if you think Meet the Press should have won an Emmy for Second Most Disinformational Series in the History of Television After Fox, or as we like to call it, Dumbed Down Fiction, Fabrication, or Comedy Programming.
Yeah. Okay.
Mm-hmm. Press 3 if you think Dick Cheney should have won an Emmy for Most Vile Lead Performance in a Fraudulent War Series.
Yeah.
Have a nice day.
You know, I was wondering when I saw your Dick Cheney story, wondering why this man is still alive. You know, anybody else? I'm serious. I'm not kidding. Because how he's like, you know, 300 years old or something already, and you know he's a vampire. And they keep giving him new hearts and robotic hearts and things. And any other human being, I mean, the private health insurance death panels would have already denied him because he's too old and infirm to get, you know, all these superhuman hearts.
He's held together with electrical tape.
Yeah.
Well, the man is a walking roll of duct tape. He is just barely there. You know, when he had that lack of heart thing where he just had this little pump or something, I really thought I was, well, I assumed because he has all the money in the world that he'd be able to afford what he needed it just in the nick of time, and that's what happened.
Yeah, but he didn't pay for it because he was a vice president.
True.
He's on, we're paying for it.
Right, that's true. But meantime, he's been revived. He's in his third life or whatever. He's like a zombie or whatever the heck he is. And he's out there doing ridiculous things and getting attention for it. This time it was a gun malfunction. He had a major gun malfunction at a charity event.
You know, let me play this. I got to tell you, you know, when I was recording it, you know, because I took the audio, I looked to see if there's any video we need, and we don't, because I don't need to see Dick Cheney's face. It'll break the computer screen. And I thought, all right, it's a minute 43. My God, it felt like it went on for 7 minutes.
Didn't it? I know.
And it's like, this is only a minute 43. It's got to be a mistake. But anyway, here's it, and this is actual, this is a news. I was thinking, wow, they got, you know, this gun club got some, like, Yahoo to narrate this video, and then it's a local news channel in Wyoming.
It made the news, exactly.
Wyoming.
Right.
Here we go.
The one-shot antelope hunt is over, and the Remington team was victorious.
They were the only team that was successful with all three of their hunters. Had they not done that, the Wyoming team would have won, because with two successes, their time was so short, Wyoming would finally have been champions again.
But wait a second. What's that? That question mark next to Vice President Dick Cheney's name.
The vice president, who's an excellent shot, he had a gun malfunction, so... but I think he is so excited and has enjoyed this so much, he'll be back next year.
I don't take it personal. I'm sure there was some flaw in the manufacturer. But I will be back next year. I've enjoyed it. It's been fantastic. It's great to spend so much time with some fine folks. Thank you very much.
Even though the vice president didn't get his goat, he helped raise money by auctioning off a copy of his book, which went for $2,600 for the nonprofit Water for Wildlife, which helps animals suffering from drought conditions.
It lowers the population of the animals. I understanding from the Game and Fish, they were down about 20% from last year's.
And while the Remington team was honored by the Shoshone tribe, the losers had to get up on stage and give an excuse.
It goes on
forever.
It
all starts with lot number R270W2. That was that box of Remington ammunition that was put into my hands. It shouldn't surprise anyone that Dick Cheney's gun had a major malfunction today. He had Remington ammunition. But the good news is, his gun didn't work and nobody got hurt.
Reporting in Lander, I'm Michael Severin, K2 News.
K2 News. Wow. You know. Mm-hmm. Wow.
Well, as I say, there are no jokes. When he said he made a joke, the good news is the gun didn't work and nobody got hurt. There's so much truth to that that it's just not funny anymore. Also, I love how Cheney blamed the gun manufacturer, who, by the way, supported him, you know, his entire life.
Right. And, well, they were all making fun of the Remington, which, by the way, you know, I'm still sort of reeling over the shooting at the Naval Yard, which, you know, America seems to be going, oh, what's next?
Yeah, just another slaughter.
Right, but there's a great piece in the New York Times about it, and I'm hoping to get the columnist, Joe Nocera, on the show one of these days. But he talks about Remington. By the way, listen to this. He wrote about... I guess Rick Warren's wife did an interview just after the shooting of at the Naval Yard, right? And he writes, watching the interview, you know, Rick Warren and his wife, their son, killed himself was finally able to get a gun. And what they said is, we're grateful the laws kept Matthew from getting the gun for as long as they did, said Rick Warren. But after years of trying, Matthew finally found someone on the internet who was willing to sell him a gun illegally. He filed down the serial number so the gun couldn't be traced. And a month after taking possession of it, he killed himself. So this guy, Joe Nocera, this columnist of the New York Times, writes, watching the interview, I couldn't help but reflect on Alexis, the shooter, who also had the kind of history, including an episode of Hearing Voices just 5 weeks earlier, that should have kept him from getting a gun. In Virginia, however, he was able to legally purchase a Remington shotgun. Remington is part of the Freedom Group, a company owned by the private equity firm Cerberus Capital. Adam Lanza used a gun from the same company in the elementary school massacre in Newtown, Connecticut. Nice. There's Remington for you. Such a nice company.
Boy. Well, first of all, there's the blame game. You know, everyone's blaming something or somebody else for massacres. Cheney's blaming the malfunction on a gun. Cheney blames September 11th, 2001 on Iraq. This is just a big, fat, round-robin circus when people's lives are at stake. People are joking about guns. Yep. Guns kill people. Yep. People kill people. Everybody kills everybody. Nobody really seems to care except the people who are directly affected, and then some of us out here who, you know, have a heart, which Cheney does not have. This is an ongoing, endless, solvable problem. I was watching... you're going to hate this. I think it was Lawrence last night who made the point that other countries, or maybe it was the president. I'm sorry. No, he was playing a clip. The president said, you know,
I have it here.
You play it?
Yep. Here's the president.
No other advanced nation endures this kind of violence. None.
None.
Here in America, the murder rate is three times what it is in other developed nations. The murder rate with guns is 10 times what it is in other developed nations. And there's nothing inevitable about it. It comes about because of decisions we make or fail to make. And it falls upon us to make it different. And sometimes it takes an unexpected voice to break through, to help remind us what we know to be true. And we heard one of those voices last week. Dr. Janice Orlowski's team at MedStar Washington Hospital Center treated the wounded. And in the midst of one of her briefings, she spoke with heartbreaking honesty as somebody who sees daily and nightly the awful carnage of so much violence. We are a great country, she said, but there's something wrong. All these shootings, all these victims, she said, this is not America. It is a challenge to all of us, she said, and we have to work together to get rid of this.
Those statistics he cited at the beginning of that piece, I have a chart. You know, I wrote a blog post the other day. My solution to the problem is have the other countries, other civilized nations in the world, issue travel advisories and say that the United States is not safe because of the gun violence. And there's a graphic here that shows the United States has by far the highest per capita rate of all developed countries. According to data compiled by the United Nations, the U.S. has four times as many gun-related homicides per capita as do Turkey and Switzerland, which are tied for third. The U.S. gun murder rate is about 20 times the average for all other countries on this chart that they have. That means Americans are 20 times as likely to be killed by a gun than is someone from another developed country. It is stunning.
It is stunning. I really loved your idea. Meantime, the reason, you know, nothing gets off the ground is money. It's always about profit. It's always about, you know, it's the gun makers who are profiting, and they give money to the NRA. And so, you know, when we're talking about either morality or the law or, you know, any rational argument for gun safety, you're going to get money as the overwhelming reason to ignore that or to fight it. And that's the problem. You know, you have a great idea that nobody is going to pay attention to because you don't have any money behind it.
Well, exactly. And, you know, look, it was cross-posted at Crooks and Liars and got a ton of comments, but, you know, mostly the comments were, you know, about the problem and not about a solution. And look, if Congress won't do anything, you got to hit them in the pocketbook. And,
exactly.
You know, but I did have somebody sort of yell at me on my blog in the comments section and say, you know, look, what this would do is hurt the poor working people, you know, in the hospitality industry, like here in South Florida, you know, all the hotels. And you know what? Sorry. I'm, you know, right now, if somebody opens fire on a South Florida beach, it will hurt it more.
Of course. No, those arguments, you know, there are other ways to compensate for any money or any profits being lost in one way by balancing it off with another. So, and as you're saying, the cost of not doing it is more. So, yeah, this is, the thing that bothers so many people, especially you and me, is when you have the misinformation overwhelming the real information about what's going on. So you've got the gun industry. Oh God, there goes my phone. The gun industry flooding the airwaves with arguments that make no sense.
Oh, of course. But look, we're used to that. They do that. The big money interests spend money, a lot of money, to to push their BS. You know, Bill Maher the other night made my point as well. Here's what he said about the shooting.
We had another mass shooting at the Navy Yard in Washington, D.C., and we went through the whole ritual. We saw it on television and the news coverage, and then Obama spoke. And Obama said a few words about it, and then he went on to another subject. And I saw a lot of conservative commentators say, how dare he on a day of a shooting? And I wanted to say, every day in America is a day of a shooting.
Plus, they should be happy, because the entire argument that's been made by people who are sort of gun rights maximalists is that essentially, you know, we are making too much of this, right? That this is just either the product of insane people, or it's the product of just horrible things happening the way that, like, sometimes 28-year-olds get stricken with cancer, and that's terrible, and stuff just happens, and we pick up the pieces and move on. That is the argument that the right has been making, that the NRA has been making, that there aren't actually policy solutions to this and we shouldn't overreach. And so what they should want, their end goal, should be a time, which they've managed to achieve, and it's quite ghastly to contemplate, in which the president just says a few words about it and then moves on.
The president is...
I think that's what we should do. Or not even say a few words about it.
Just ignore. You think the same thing. You think we should just, like...
For different reasons, but yes, because we're never going to do anything about this, and I'm tired of hearing about the shooters. I don't care about them. I don't care about what we know for sure. What I know for sure is we're not going to do anything, because both parties love guns. Joe Biden said, buy a shotgun. That's what this guy did. He bought a shotgun.
You know, it's true. Look, and my point was that, you know, look, if Congress hasn't been motivated to do something after, you know, the shooting in the head of one of their colleagues at a constituent event in front of a Safeway supermarket, or the murders of 26 and 7-year-olds in their first grade classroom, then, you know what, the shooting of, you know, these middle-aged people, that's old hat. You know, who cares?
Well, I'm so glad you played that clip. That was my favorite part of the show that night, mm-hmm. Where Bill Maher said, what's the point of pointing out, you know, these massacres when you've got thousands of people dying every year, in a matter of months that we've already, you know, since Newtown, we've had, I don't know how many thousands of people die at the point of a gun, and nobody blinks an eye.
Yes. No, you're right, and that's what it's going to be now. You know, a few people have used the term the new normal. In fact, President Obama on Sunday, that clip I played of him, was Sunday during just his latest memorial, the thing that he had to speak at because more people were killed. And he said, I don't want this to be the new normal. But you know what? It is. This is the American way of life now. And that's why I said other countries should issue a travel advisory. And my idea actually came from, you know, the aftermath of the killing of that Australian baseball player, college student in Oklahoma, by those three bored teenagers. Remember that?
Yeah.
The right wing talking heads tried to claim it was all about. Race. And why, where's Al Sharpton? Well, of course, one of the kids was black, one of them was mixed race, and the third was black. You know, it had nothing to do with race. And unlike the Trayvon Martin killing, right? But what happened is the Deputy Prime Minister of Australia, after this young man was murdered, actually released a statement. I thought I had read that there was a, you know, that Australia issued a travel advisory. They didn't. I went to the Australia government website to see, and of course, you know, it's just your typical, what they have up there is, you know, typical travel warnings, beware of, you know, terrorists, you know, as in any other country, but it was, there was nothing specific, you know, no warnings against traveling to the United States. And this, I'm trying to load this page again, and now it doesn't want to load because I've got too much shit running on my, my internet sucks. Thank you, AT&T. but you know, the Deputy Prime Minister of Australia did make a pretty tough statement along the lines of, you know, I wouldn't travel to the United States. It's not safe. And that's why I thought there needs to be a formal travel advisory against coming here.
Well, that's the thing. Until it hits them, until the side who are these gun fondlers are hit directly by something that affects them,
gun fondlers,
they don't care. If it was a Republican who got hit in the head instead of Gabby Giffords, would that have made a difference?
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's just unbelievable. Until it hits them in the pocketbook or hits them personally, until they have a reason to justify it, nothing is ever going to get done. Or
right.
Until, like you said, some outside force, like another country, saying, you know what, we're not going to recommend
safe.
That our people travel
right.
to you. We're
okay.
going to hit you in the tourism industry.
Here's the quote. Australia's Deputy Prime Minister Tim Fisher said this. And actually, I think he said it on CNN, on Piers Morgan's show. It is another example of murder mayhem on Main Street. People thinking of going to the USA for business or tourist trips should think carefully about it, given the statistical fact that you are 15 times more likely to be shot dead in the USA than in Australia per capita.
Mm-hmm. There.
Now, make it official. You know, if Australia puts that up as a travel advisory, I have a feeling people might say, oh, shit, this is going to cost us money. We need to fix this problem.
But that's where it always matters. It's always about money. Unfortunately, it's not about the morality. It's not about the deaths. It's not about the sorrow. It's not about killing. It's about money.
Yep.
And way too, just like campaign finance laws get in the way of good governing, you know, this is money. It should not be that way, but that's the way it is. And they call us a socialist society. Really, GOP? Seriously?
Yeah. Right. No, it's insane. And you know what? I mean, this is...
Guns in the news.
You know, it's an everyday thing. It's an everyday thing. It sounds like there were a couple of kids arrested in Chicago for the 13 people shot just the other day. I mean, it's almost every day.
People. Do you know that in the LA Times yesterday they ran a piece that said, we don't know what's going on in this city, but we had a series of 10 different gun incidents or murders or shootings or whatever, and we're not understanding what's happening. And they went on to list one after the other. Some were police related, you know, where there was a shootout. Some were drive-by shootings. Some mm-hmm. were gang related. Some were regular old, you know, your run-of-the-mill oops shootings or some kind of a blow-up between two people shootings. But there was a rash of killings of people dying at the point of a gun, and the people, I can't remember which public official, but you know, in Los Angeles were scratching their heads going, what's going on here? Well, what's going on here is the norm.
Yeah, this is the new normal. Welcome to it. This is the United States, the gun capital of the world. You know, for those who bemoan the fact that we don't manufacture anything, we don't export anything, yeah, we do. Guns, weapons.
Yeah.
We manufacture and export weapons. I think we are the number one gun manufacturer because we are the gun capital of the world.
Yeah, we love our guns. Oh, boy.
Yep.
Not me. I can't stand to look at a gun.
Now what happened? A University of Kansas professor on leave after tweet to NRA?
Yeah, speaking of guns, this University of Kansas, his name is David W. Guth. I think that's how you say his name.
Guth? Okay.
Guth, G-U-T-H. And he put out a tweet after the Navy Yard shootings that said, quote, blood is on the hands of the NRA. Next time, let it be your sons and daughters. Now, that's pretty harsh.
Okay.
But it was just, it's a tweet, okay?
Right.
And he said he did it to get the conversation going. That was exactly what I wanted to do. And he agreed when they gave him indefinite administrative leave, he agreed that that was appropriate, that he wanted to start the conversation. But what he didn't like was that the those on the who were so much for the Second Amendment were trying to suppress his First Amendment rights, and they wanted him fired. And the people that wanted him fired, get this, Kansas Senate Majority Leader Terry Bruce, a Republican who's received $2,500 in campaign contributions from the NRA since 2004, and the NRA spokesman said, this is hate speech. It is disgusting and deplorable. It has no place in our society. But killings apparently are okay with
him. I guess. Wow.
Yeah.
Wow. That's, you know, I'm sorry.
As I said, the professor did not shoot a gun. He shot off his mouth. Big difference. Nobody died. If it was offensive, fine. He said this is, you know, he purposely intended it to be controversial, and he agreed that he should be temporarily relieved of
right.
his,
right.
whatever.
You know,
but he didn't kill anyone.
No, of course not. And you know what? He's right to call out the NRA because they're the ones putting big money behind the effort to stop any kind of sensible regulations, including background checks, which is something that they proposed in the past, and you know, any kind of database. Well, you know what? Sorry, gun owners. The NRA has a database of gun owners. So,
exactly.
You know, it's just hypocrisy. Speaker to Animals in the chat room just wrote, the reason for the Second Amendment is to allow states to have state-controlled militia to put down the 250-plus slave rebellions, not
right.
to protect the individual from the government. In fact, one of the tasks of the militia in Georgia was to take away any weapons the slaves might have. And that's true, but you know what? You know, again, these right-wingers love to cite the Constitution, the Second Amendment, but they ignore the first four words, which state a well-regulated militia. And
exactly.
then, I don't know if you heard about this story I reported on last week. In Texas, you know, where they write all the textbooks, by the way, there was an AP history study guide. It wasn't even a textbook, and it was a 764-page book. There was one line in it about the Second Amendment, and its translation, if you will, of the Second Amendment said that the Second Amendment, and I'm paraphrasing here because I don't remember exactly, but something like the Second Amendment provided for state militias to be allowed to own guns, or state militia members to be allowed to own guns. And you know what? That is the literal translation of it. It may not be how the Supreme Court recently translated it, but that's the literal definition of it. And for that, there was this huge uproar by some parents in Texas. How dare they put this in the textbook? Meanwhile, I quoted a whole litany of, you know, their Texas textbook authors or legislators rewriting history for their textbooks.
Yeah, it's a little hypocritical.
You think?
You know, and also the Second Amendment says right to bear arms, but it doesn't say you can't, it doesn't say your right to bear every kind of arms.
No, you're not allowed to have a rocket launcher. You're not allowed to have grenades in your home.
Right, so for these people who were saying, you're going to come and take my gun away, well, no, if we're going to take any guns away, it's certain types of guns, the one that are not intended to kill animals for hunting purposes or to defend yourself in your own house.
Right.
You don't need 100 rounds or 30 rounds. You don't need a semi-automatic
right.
weapon, the assault-style rifle, if an intruder comes in.
Well, so, of course not.
And, of course, the chances go up if you own a gun way up that somebody in your house will die and it won't be the intruder. So.
Well,
there you
no,
go.
Right, exactly. And, you know, the whole thing is just, it's so infuriating. And then you get the gun nuts. What did you call them? The gun...
Gun fondlers.
Gun fondlers. I like that. So the gun fondlers who say, well, you know, when the government comes, I need to be able to protect myself against them. Yeah, you and your little guns. I'm sorry, even if you have an AR-15,
right.
Sorry, the government wants you. They'll just fucking drop a bomb on your house with a drone.
Yeah,
you cannot fight back.
They won't even... need to drop a bomb.
They want to get you, they're going to get you.
Yeah.
I don't care how many guns you have.
Talk about David and Goliath.
Right.
I mean, it's insane. The things that come out of there, do they even think, and then they say, well, no, it's worth it. We'll die going down with our guns. You know, they'll die going down on their guns.
Yeah, no shit. Ka-ching. You know, one other thing that's really kind of, you know, fucked up, is that the story you have about the first responders during the Navy Yard massacre, their
yes.
radios didn't work. They couldn't communicate with each other.
This is so heartbreaking and so infuriating. When I first started blogging, before I even knew how, Cliff Schechter, who I was then blogging for, said, can you write up this story? I'm too busy with my book. And it's about how the first responders in 9/11, Rudy Giuliani never fixed their radios, and so a bunch of them died, right? So we all know that story.
Well, and they didn't, the various, like the police and the firefighters, their radios didn't communicate with each other. There was no coordination in the emergency community to coordinate, to communicate with each other.
121 firefighters died because of that, and so I wrote up this long thing, and I keep bringing it back. It was one of my favorite posts because it makes the point so well, and it's happening again. This is from The Hill. Radios for federal firefighters and police officers failed during the mass shooting at the Navy Yard, according to union representatives for first responders. After the first shootout with the gunman, one officer found his radio's battery was dead, while another officer could not receive a signal from his radio and was unable to call for help. That forced them to use an officer's cell phone to call others outside the building. And so the union guy, he's Anthony Mealy, chairman of the Fraternal Order of Police Naval District Washington Labor Committee, said that the problems with their radios have been a known issue on the base, with radio batteries not being able to hold a charge and being unable to receive signals inside buildings. And he said it was sad that police officers had to use each other's cell phones to call for help. They didn't even have, for those who didn't have a cell phone, they had to borrow a cell phone.
Wow. You know, there's no excuse for this.
None.
No
12
excuse.
Years later, none. And it's fixable. This isn't one of those things like, oh, my God, how are we going to do this? You know, this is really a tough problem. Can we get money for it? How are we going to do this? It's called proper equipment. How hard is it to get a working radio?
Yeah, exactly. I'm sorry. And look, I understand. This was it may not have been a military base, but it was a military installation. And do you know that the security guard was a private contractor?
Yeah, the private contractors
who was an old guy who was an old guy who was killed, you know, and the shooter took his gun. I mean, really? You know, the whole idea of private contractors. I'm sorry. Yes, the shooter was a private contractor too.
Mm-hmm.
They don't have enough people in the military who can do these jobs? Because I promise you, the private contractors get paid more money than the enlisted actual military people.
And there's your vicious cycle. You've got, the military that's less expensive, but they want to come over to be private contractors because they get paid more.
Right.
But then the private contractors are profit oriented, which means they aren't doing their jobs for doing, you know, because they're part of the military. They're doing their jobs for money.
Yep.
And there are all kinds of, you know, lack of regulation and lack of oversight and on and on and on. So you've got this catch 22, which shouldn't have to be a catch. Again, it's an easily solved problem.
Of course not. But then you have, you know, things like, you point out, this is what Meet the Press has come to.
Oh, God, just kill me now.
Yeah, you want to talk about this? Because, you know, with all this stuff going on, now I got to say on Meet the Press, They had Wayne LaPierre on, and all I heard coming out of his mouth was like, rah, 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 rah. It was like the teacher and Charlie Brown. But what we did notice is that Wayne LaPierre was on there for a good 10 minutes, blah, 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 spouting his bullshit. And then they had the mother of somebody who was killed in the Aurora movie theater massacre, and they had her on probably for 90 seconds.
And then when Lawrence had her on last night, she was talking and it was great, and then oops, the transmission went out and she blacked out. So about a minute of her time on the air was gone.
Oh my God.
So she just keeps getting cut off. But yeah, Meet the Press. I didn't watch Wayne LaPierre because I will not watch Wayne LaPierre.
You didn't, that's all I heard.
Well, that's all he does. There's no point in having that guy on, except to try to get ratings and stir up some trouble, which is insane. This is what the news has come to, because it's been commercialized, and because when it's commercialized, again, it's for profit, and there you go. So here we go. Rather than discuss, I don't know, Iran or, you know, Syria or our state of the economy or what's going on in the House of Representatives or anything else. Well, they did some of that, but what they did was they did their own poll. They conducted a survey, of the House of Representatives to see if they used more iPhones or more Androids or Blackberries. They did three separate polls overall, Republicans and Democrats, to see what they use. I didn't even, I don't know the result. I mean, I have one sentence here. I don't care about the results. So they spent their time conducting polls, and that probably took money, of course, because you're paying someone to do
it. Because that's what's important, that 58% of the House of Representatives use an iPhone, 23% use a BlackBerry, and only 4% use Android. Wow.
And that makes a difference in my life. How? Oh, yes, it doesn't. So instead of really doing, you know, good reporting, good investigating, instead of, hey, I know, challenging your guests when they lie, Chuck Todd, why don't you, you know, just conduct a survey instead, because it's so much more entertaining.
It is unbelievable. You know, it's September 24th, right? Next week, a week from today is October 1st. October 1st is two things happen on that day. One is the exchanges go live for Obamacare. It's when, you know, we can actually go online and see what insurance plans we can buy, figure out how much of a subsidy we're going to get from the government, how much it's going to cost us each month. But it's also the day that if Congress doesn't get its shit together, the government shuts down. I wonder how that's going to affect the exchanges. Do you have any idea?
No.
Nor do I.
That's my answer.
Right. I don't either. And I you would think that somebody would bring this up. I have not heard one mention of it.
That they've been trying to. The GOP has done everything they can in several states to stop the group, and I've forgotten what they call themselves now, but they help people through the exchange system. They're like monitors in a way. You need help, I'm here for you.
Right. They're called navigators.
Navigators. Thank you. Could not think of that name. So I don't know if they're directly affected by this or if they will continue on their merry way, but they're doing everything they can to make this a failure, but what they're really doing is preventing people from getting a life-saving medical attention.
Right.
It's just amazing to me that what's more important to them is to make Obama look like a failure or just, you know, to do their little right-wing thing and to not get primaried as opposed to helping Americans who voted for them.
Right. No, exactly. And, you know, every time I see one of those Ted Cruz or Mike Lee commercials to defund Obamacare, I want to call their offices and say, why do you not want us to have health insurance?
Right. Well,
why do you not want me to be able to go to the doctor?
Yeah, or why can't my kid get that life-saving cancer operation that he needs, that he's able to do now that Obamacare provides for my child?
It's just amazing. And now, the next thing, but the following week, it's the second Tuesday in October? Is it the first Tuesday in October? One of them, the first Tuesday in October or the second Tuesday in October, I forget, is when the Supreme Court reconvenes. It's when the new session of the Supreme Court starts. So it's coming up.
October 8th.
So it's the second Tuesday in October is when it is. And so that's October 8th. And that's when they're going to take up an appeal from the RNC, Senator Mitch McConnell, and Alabama businessman Sean McCutcheon, who say that political contributions should be treated as core political speech. This is not a challenge to Citizens United. This is to double down on Citizens United. This is to take it to the next level.
This is son of Citizens United. Citizens United squared. What did you say?
Squared.
Yes, you said the same thing.
There you go.
It's what they call Act 2 in the LA Times. Act 2, in the decline and fall of campaign funding laws, the Supreme Court appears poised to lift the lid on the total amount of the wealthy can give directly to all candidates and political parties. Now, it says here that, where's my numbers?
The current law allows the rich to give millions to super PACs and other groups that pay for independent election ads. What they cannot do is give more than $48,600 total to all members of Congress or more than $74,600 to various party committees. Those restrictions may end.
Yes, then both political parties could each donate up to $3.6 million, which could be funneled by party leaders into a close race or races, tipping the balance in Congress. So if you're rich, you buy your candidate.
Of course.
And McConnell is doing this because, of course, he's facing a primary challenge from his little Tea Partier guy, and because he's running against Allison Lundgren Grimes, who is beating him in the polls.
Yep. Yeah, it's stunning. So we have that to look forward to, and of course, Scalia didn't die. Sadly, I don't often wish death on anyone, but it's the only way we're going to get him off the Supreme Court. And I say Scalia because he's the oldest. Mm-hmm. Ruth Bader Ginsburg, although I love her, I'm glad she's there. I worry that she'll, you know, live long enough to see another president elected, and and that some Republican might get in there. Which, please, you know, I as much as I'm not happy with Obama and the job he's done, I'm really not. I want a Democrat to pick the next Supreme Court justice. Look, I think Sonia Sotomayor is great. Mm-hmm. Elena Kagan is still better than anyone sitting on the other side of the court, if you will.
Yeah, but she keeps having to recuse herself.
Yes, she does. So that's a vote, you know, for the right side that it doesn't get cast.
Right.
And I'd rather have another Kagan than another Scalia or Alito or, you know, Roberts.
Yeah,
sorry.
Although in this particular article about the Supreme Court, you know, this ruling about Citizens United's son of, mm-hmm. they say Roberts may very well be the vote that goes against this.
Well,
what part of the article was about. So who knows?
Well, he's also the vote that saved the Affordable Care Act, which is shocking. But,
yeah.
You know, he's worried about his legacy, you know. There's one more thing that I need to play. And what's really sad is that, you know, you had Tweety say that that Rand Paul is going to be the GOP nominee for the presidency,
yes,
in 2016. And
you watch. This is what I do for a living.
You watch. He called it. This is what he does for a living. So Rand Paul, where was he speaking when he said this? Do we know?
Yeah. Where do I have it? On Thursday. Oh, shoot. I thought I had it, but
he was somewhere.
It
doesn't matter. Rand Paul was running his mouth.
Oh, here, at the Liberty Political Action Conference in Virginia.
Okay. Rand Paul was in Virginia, yeah. And here's a little snippet of what Rand Paul had to say.
Does anybody remember Charlie Sheen when he was kind of going crazy last year? And he's going around, jumping around, saying, winning, winning, we're winning. Well, I kind of feel like that. I think we are winning. And I'm not on any drugs.
Yeah, right.
He should be.
Yeah. You know, if we're going to drug test anyone, I think we should drug test two groups, members of Congress and Wall Street bankers.
And don't forget Republican legislators, but
well, okay.
That would take too much time, I guess.
I hear you.
Yeah. But no, yeah. Rand Paul is saying that Republicans are like a loser who was on drugs.
Yeah.
Who said winning, but he was losing.
And on that note, it doesn't get any weirder than that. Gotta Laugh. Find her at thepoliticalcarnival.net. And here on Tuesdays, although next Tuesday we won't be doing a show because I'm going to be doing a show live on AM 760 from Denver. Although, you know what? If you want to put together some maybe Obamacare stories, we can do a segment. Because that's what I'm going to be focusing on, because it's the day the exchanges start.
We can
talk.
Let's talk.
We'll talk.
We'll talk.
Okay. Bye, Laffy.
Bye.
All right. And let's see. I will leave you today with another song. This one is from Gil Scott-Heron, and in light of the discussion we had in the first hour about nukes and Fukushima. This one's called "We Almost Lost Detroit."
That ain't cool.
Talk to you all tomorrow. Thanks, everyone.
Recently, they have re-released some material that we did with an organization called the Musicians United for Safe Energy. They were called Muse, and the movie was called No Nukes. And we did a song on the album, No Nukes. It was about an accident that took place about 30 miles west of Detroit. And in that song that we recorded in 1977, we mentioned a young lady named Karen Silkwood, whose case would be decided some 6 or 7 years later. We want you to understand that somebody's always got to be on the job. Somebody's always got to be on the job because there's always a job out there to do. This is a song here called We Almost Lost Detroit. Thank you.
stands out on the highway like a creature from another time.